aside, what I treasure most about David is his solid common sense in writing about nutrition. So please join me in welcoming David Katz to tell us what Paleo Man really ate.
Thank you. Thanks very much. Pleasure to be here. And by the way, whole grains figure prominently in the Katz family diet. And nobody paid me to say that, and nobody pays us to eat them. I just really think this is part of a healthy diet for me and the people I love most in the world. And frankly, that's the truest expression of how I translate science into action I can think of. And it's unfortunate that the authors of Wheat Belly and Grain Brain aren't here, because if they were, I would invite the former to jump up and declare me fat for eating wheat, and the latter to jump up and decry me stupid for eating whole grains. I invite the rest of you, however, to pay attention and reserve judgment. Let's talk about what should be on the menu. And as we look back at the Paleolithic diet, which is not a principal focus of my work, I'm just interested in all of the different arguments competing for the best diet laurels, and this is a popular modern theme. Are there any reasons to care about the Paleolithic diet? Isn't it really just yesterday's news? What's the devilry in the details? Why is there so much argument here, as apparently everywhere else, in discussions about nutrition? Can we identify, even among the principal protagonists in this debate, a recipe for consensus? What do people really do when they attempt to live Stone Age style? And my argument is, they're just rocking the rubric. In other words, I'm saying it's paleo, but I'm doing whatever the hell I really want. Those who argue for a paleo diet may be committing the time-honored error of substituting perfect that is unattainable for good that is, and I'll try to characterize that. Make the case that if we're really looking to history and tradition as an argument for dietary patterns, that we really are talking about a proud vintage of grains as a signature component of the human diet. And then provide a little bit of context about diet and health overall, because I think that that is where we should be basing our decisions, not in the heat of argument over any given particular detail. And then we will collectively chew on the implications and call it a day, or at least a morning. In terms of reasons to care, anyone who's seen me present before has seen this slide. It's my figurative trademark, the polar bear in the Sahara, and it generally is an important theme in the things I have to say about why we're in the fix we're in, why we have epidemic obesity and diabetes. That's a topic for another day. For today's purposes, this slide is an indelible reminder that creatures are adapted to their environments. They adapt and survive, or they fail to adapt and they fail to survive. It's really that simple. And there is a unique Homo sapien arrogance that tends to think of us as somehow separate from all the rest of nature. And of course we're not. And we too are adapted to a native habitat. And the modern world isn't it. And the modern nutritional environment isn't it. And to the extent that discussions of the paleo diet are a reminder that we are creatures subject to the influence of natural selection and adaptation to an environment, it's a useful discussion to have. Polar bears are imperiled, not because they aren't marvels of survival in one of the Earth's harshest climates, but because they are so specifically adapted to that climate. And so when the climate changes, they can't necessarily keep up. Well, frankly, there are arguments to make that we're much the same. We haven't kept up with changes in modern living, changes in our physical activity level, changes in our sleep, stress, and in particular diets, and we are reaping the metabolic whirlwind. So I think there's an argument across the full expanse of nature, nor need we look so far. We know a lot about our own adaptations. Unfortunately, they tend to look a bit like this, as you all, I trust, know. I am a little optimistic about this trend. I figure the sodas might get so big in light of Michael Bloomberg's failure that there's actually a physical activity benefit from carrying them around. And then all will be well. The other reason I think there is some legitimacy to the paleo diet argument comes from the hard work that I've done writing textbooks. We just published the third edition of our nutrition textbook, Nutrition and Clinical Practice. It came out in September. About 700 pages, diet and its relationship to all of the conditions we treat in internal medicine, about 10,000 citations. If you haven't written a textbook, don't. It's like going to jail. It's truly, it's just horrible. Anyway, the damn thing is done. But You know, in writing 50 chapters and 700 pages and looking at all this evidence, one of the things that struck me was the remarkable consistency with which the best current science-based recommendations for nutrient intake levels correspond to the predictions of paleoanthropologists working completely independently. Just as a for instance, this audience probably all knows that back in 1989, the RDA for folate was 200 micrograms a day. And the RDA for folate was bumped up in the most recent iteration of the DRIs to 400 micrograms a day. And that was done not because of anything paleoanthropologists said, but because 400 micrograms a day was associated, if women consumed that much around the time of conception, with a dramatic decline in neural tube defects, type of congenital anomaly. Right? So the science was strong. The RDA was 400 micrograms a day. If you look at the work of paleoanthropologists regarding folate, they estimate, on the basis of the things they study, modern-day hunter-gatherers to some extent, but also dental wear patterns in fossils and coprolithes, which is fossilized fecal remains, they estimate that our ancestral intake of folate was 380 to 420 micrograms a day. That's stunning. That's a bullseye, and it's totally independent work. Much the same is true of essential fatty acids. You know, kind of weird that we would all benefit from eating so much fish oil. I mean, what's up with that, right? I mean, did our ancestors eat so much fish? Well, no, the reality is we've domesticated omega-3 fat out of other species. So the flesh of antelope contains omega-3. The flesh of grain-fed cattle does not. So modern beef cattle, none. The kind of meat our ancestors ate, plenty. And so there's actually a strong argument for a higher intake of omega-3. And again, the estimates from the paleoanthropologists of what our native intake level is and the work on the anti-inflammatory benefits of omega-3 in the diet correspond perfectly. And you see that time and again. Vitamin E is another good example, and I won't belabor it, you get the idea. So yes, I think our native adaptations are relevant. So I didn't come here this morning to throw paleo under the bus. And there is an argument as well that if we return to our native prehistoric lifestyle, that a lot of our modern ills might go away. One important comment, I'll make it now because it's as good a time as any. It does seem, and there's some argument, these days we can bicker about just about everything, apparently. So everything we thought we knew is resurrected, and we bicker about it. But what we had all heard, and what to the best of my knowledge is still fundamentally true, is that the average life expectancy in the Paleolithic era, for much of it, didn't extend much beyond 40. Right? So the argument that we can prevent diseases that tend to get us in the 5th, 6th, 7th, 8th decade with a lifestyle that was only widely practiced for a four-decade-long life, I think, is a bit of a leap of faith. That being said, there is an argument here that if you live this native lifestyle, it is likely to be associated with some metabolic improvements, an attenuation of cardiometabolic risk in particular. So that's sort of the general view of the paleo diet and its relevance, but there's a lot of devilry in the details. And in particular, the work of Lauren Cordain, who has a site for the paleo diet, has taken arguments about paleo eating in a very carnivorous direction. And I suspect this audience knows Lauren Cordain, and I suspect maybe certain members of this audience don't love him all that much. But he's a serious paleoanthropologist. He's just chosen to study modern-day hunter-gatherers and has somehow settled on populations that eat an awful lot of meat. He argues that 60% of their calories come from meat, and the remaining 40% or thereabouts come from plant foods. And that may be true in certain modern-day hunter-gatherers. I don't know that that proves it to be true of hunter-gatherers living in a prehistoric world. And although Boyd Eaton and Connor have at times collaborated with Cordain, as they do in that first citation, most of their writing has emphasized that we were, in fact, gatherers at least as much as we were ever hunters. And our diet was a mix of widely varied plants and whatever we could catch by hunting. So the paleoanthropologists themselves are arguing a bit. Were we hunter-gatherers or were we gather-hunters? We might pause, though, long enough to note that either way, we ate a wide variety of plant foods and we ate wild animals. And that's critically important because, again, if you compare the flesh of domestic cattle to antelope, about 35% of the calories in modern beef cattle, depending on the cut of meat, come from fat, much of it saturated. Compare that to antelope. About 7% of the calories come from fat, almost none of it saturated, and quite a bit of it omega-3, which is totally absent from the modern beef cattle. We all know the expression, you are what you eat. What I think we tend to forget is that what we eat is what it eats. And if you're going to adopt a paleo diet, you want to eat animals that have a paleo diet. And I don't think anybody even really thinks very much about that. But it's interesting, if we look for consensus even among the arguing paleoanthropologists, we get this from Cordain himself. So that, you know, at the carnivorous end of the spectrum, there was a high intake of antioxidants, fiber, vitamins, and phytochemicals. What are phytochemicals? Plant-based nutrients, right? Now, the fiber is particularly important. Everything I've read suggests that our native intake level for fiber is about 100 grams a day. Typical American gets about 12. We'd all benefit from 25, 30, or even 50. 100's probably pushing it, unless you've got plenty of time to spend in the bathroom. And I think most of us are just too damn busy for that. We don't want to wander the savannah and squat every 15 minutes. All right, so no thanks to 100, but interesting that that's the level to which we're probably adapted. Now, you know, in for a penny, in for a pound. If the paleo diet is relevant, then it's relevant in its details, and 100 grams of fiber begs the question, how are you going to get there from here, given the modern diet? One of the obvious answers is whole grains, right? So you could argue whole grains may not have been a food we ate in the Paleolithic era, but you could also argue they are a very valuable source of a nutrient that figured very prominently even in the characterization of the paleo diet at the carnivorous end of the spectrum. Interesting. Anyway, the other things were low salt intake. We've got a problem with that. More physical activity, less stress. They also slept well, presumably in accord with the cycles of light, and there was no smoking, clearly. And if you look at what Eaton and Connor have to say, you know, pretty much the same emphasis, much lower levels of refined carbohydrates and sodium, but much higher levels of fiber. They did have higher protein. Maybe that's good, maybe it's not. You know, again, I think the issue is what is the source of that protein, and also what's good for a 4-decade lifespan may or may not be good for an 8-decade lifespan. Really, the ills of high protein don't show up early in life. By the way, you know, our Paleolithic ancestors were pretty beefy, too, and they may have needed those muscles to survive. We do know there's a benefit of high protein intake in competitive bodybuilders. You know, compared to us, they were all competitive bodybuilders back then, so it may have been a totally different lifestyle demanding the higher protein. But we really don't know what that would do in the 7th or 8th decade of life, which most of us can expect to see. They had a fairly comparable level of fat intake, but again, primarily unsaturated. All these arguments about increasing saturated fat, we don't have time to get into that this morning. I have a different mission, but totally bogus nonsense. I've written about it. I suspect Jim's written about it. So check that out. Cholesterol levels, though, were fairly high, and I think that's a valid argument. I think we're well adapted to dietary cholesterol. It came from eggs, it came from organ meats, it came from bone marrow. And when we look at the epidemiologic literature, dietary cholesterol does not correlate very strongly with blood levels of cholesterol or cardiovascular risk. So again, the relevance of the paleo diet, I think there's a there. But most people aren't interested in the relevant elements of the paleo diet. They just want an excuse to eat what they want to eat. So I think part of the reason I'm here is the stuff I've written, like the paleo diet, can we really eat like our Stone Age ancestors? And the answer, of course, is no, because almost everything they ate is extinct. So the best you can do is approximate it, but most people don't want to approximate. They want to procrastinate for pastrami, right? So they fly the paleo diet banner and have this for lunch. Folks, there was no Paleolithic pastrami. That is not controversial, right? It really isn't. And I found this on the internet, and I thought this was a perfect characterization. This is the fantasy, right? I am a caveman. I eat hamburgers, and you know, maybe they do or don't have the French fries. I'm not sure. And then the problem really with the argument is it does set perfect up as the enemy of good. If we were going to live like Paleolithic people, we would hunt. You know, yes, we would eat mammoth, but we would be the ones who hunt the mammoth. So arduous physical activity. So you know, there's no way anybody talking about the paleo diet is even vaguely attempting to approximate this. And this is a fairly violent existence, and again, associated with a lifespan of about 40 years. Nobody wants that. Whatever the gathering was, it mostly involved gathering plants that we don't have today and did not involve gathering the plants that we do. So the best we can hope to do is approximate the fundamental pattern if you think paleo is the banner we should be aiming toward. And we don't have a lot of time to hang around in caves and paint the walls either. I mean, life has just changed. So I'm not sure that there's all that much merit in perfectly matching a paleo lifestyle. What you want to look at is what are the salient elements? And the salient elements are what we're adapted to, what we've eaten in the past that seems to be associated with health, what's natural, what's close to nature, what's minimally processed. There are a number of useful elements there. And also diet as an element in overall lifestyle. It really isn't just about the diet. It's about the high level of physical activity and so forth. But if we think it important to derive inspiration for tomorrow's breakfast from some long tradition, I would argue that the grains in our diet have a pretty impressive vintage. So, for instance, grains figured prominently in the diet in ancient, what have I got here, Greece or Rome? I think I started with Greece. No, that was Rome. I got Rome before Greece, sorry. All right, anyway, ancient Romans ate grains. The Greeks did before them. Figured prominently in the diet in ancient Egypt before that. And if we look further east, in the diet of ancient China as well. And we're talking about different grains. So wheat and barley were very prominent to the west. Millet and rice more prominent to the east. But we're talking about, you know, all of the great civilizations in human history that were not bedeviled as we are by epidemic obesity and diabetes. These people did fine. And you know, the topic of gluten intolerance and what that has to do with whether we've so mucked up our microbiomes in the modern era that we're reacting to gluten differently than we once did, and that's why it's more prevalent. All sorts of interesting discussions there as well. But we could look back much further than this. Grains have figured in the human diet for at least 15,000 years since the advent of agriculture. There are some fossil remains, and this is one of the contentious points that the paleoanthropologists debate, and I'm not a card-carrying paleoanthropologist. I'm an amateur. I just read what they write. So I can't enter that fray with legitimate credentials. I just read it, and I have seen that some fossil findings suggest maybe we did eat some grains before the advent of agriculture. They were available in uncultivated plants, and maybe they figured in the diet on occasion. Possible. But we don't have to go that far. 15,000 years. We've been eating them for 15,000 years. We have not had epidemic obesity and type 2 diabetes in children for anything more than the last 50. So, you know, why go back so far? The question for us all is, if we're going to look back to then to seek inspiration for now, when exactly is then? It could be 15,000 years ago, in which case grains have always been a part of the landscape. And if 15,000 isn't long enough, then why 50,000? Why not go back 6 million years to when we diverged in our evolution from the chimpanzees, at which time our diet was pretty much vegan, right? So much for Lauren Cordain. Now, importantly, to me, the issue really isn't just about paleo diet and anthropologists arguing with one another. The context here is, what do we know about diet and health? And the answer is everything we need to know to eliminate 80% of all chronic disease or more. And the information can be traced back to surprising sources. So when McGinnis and Feige wrote Actual Causes of Death in the United States in 1993, they didn't do it as nutritionists. They were just epidemiologists looking at actuarial data. But what they found is that all of the premature deaths in our country are attributable to a list of 10 factors. And topping the list in 1990 was tobacco, poor diet, and lack of physical activity. And poor diet mostly meant failure to eat things like vegetables, fruits, and whole grains. And I'll come back to that in a second. This was reaffirmed a decade later by Ali Magdad, and others found exactly the same thing. And then here, we really get a very compelling case for the fundamental simplicity of eating well. Earl Ford and colleagues conducted survey research among 23,000 adults in and around Potsdam, Germany, asked them about four factors: tobacco use, diet, physical activity, and weight control, and they compared, I don't smoke, I eat well, I'm active, my weight's fine, to I smoke, eat badly, don't exercise, my weight's out of control. And these people, over the course of their lifetimes, had 80% less heart disease, cancer, stroke, diabetes, yes, dementia as well, than these people. And for so 80% reduction in the risk of all chronic disease and premature death. And for our purposes, the critical takeaway is, what did they mean when they said, do you eat well? How did they characterize it so people could answer the question? Habitual intake of vegetables, fruits, and whole grains. That was the marker. And it was enough. It was enough, despite all of the argument, despite the verbiage in cyberspace. People who routinely eat vegetables, fruits, and whole grains as compared to people who don't, that's part of a formula associated with an 80% reduction in the lifetime risk of all chronic disease. It was a retrospective cohort study. And it's not just one study, it's paper after paper after paper reaffirming this in the UK and the US over and over again. And the same basic dietary pattern is associated with modifying the behavior of our genes. So Dean Ornish and colleagues studied early stage prostate cancer, gave men who didn't need immediate treatment an optimal lifestyle program, including a diet rich in vegetables, fruits, and whole grains. 500 cancer promoter genes were turned off, 50 cancer suppressor genes were upregulated. The power of lifestyle, and the best evidence we had indicates that whole grains are included in it, is such that it can modify the behavior of our very genes. We can nurture nature. In the epigenetic age, DNA is not destiny. To a far greater degree, dinner is, and breakfast and lunch. And so eating well is really important. And this, too, is a literature that's filling up fast. And then fresher still, paper just out in JACC associated a basically healthy diet in the context of a basically healthy lifestyle with an 80% reduction in the incidence of myocardial infarction in men. Guess what the basically healthy diet was? Plenty of vegetables, fruits, whole grains, the usual suspects, over and over and over again. And although this may seem remote, we just heard in the Q&A the argument for storytelling, and I need to be quite succinct this morning, but I routinely point out that our problem is not what we don't know. Our problem is the failure to use what we do, the common ground, the stuff that is best defended by science and sense alike, because if knowledge were power and we used what we know, we could eliminate 80% of all heart disease, 90% of all diabetes, as much as 60% of all cancer today. We don't need another Nobel Prize. We know enough. And the bickering is all about the residual 20% we don't know how to eliminate. It is a cultural tragedy not to act on what we know while bickering over what we don't and creating a market for fad diets that really help nobody. It is a tragedy. It's a travesty. We have to do everything in our power to put an end to it. And one of the problems is the lack of compelling stories, because when we talk about public health statistics, like an 80% reduction in all chronic disease, it's anonymous. Public is nameless, faceless, and impossible to love. And I won't dwell on this morning or ask you to show hands. Well, I will ask you to show hands. Everybody in the room who loves somebody who has ever been affected by heart disease, cancer, stroke, or diabetes, please raise your hand for just a sec. Right? These things have invaded every one of our families. An 80% reduction in all chronic disease means 8 out of 10 of us in this room would not have cause to raise our hands. It's not remote, it's up close and personal. We need to make people feel that so we act on what we know. When we part the veil of statistical anonymity, the faces we see looking back at us are the faces of people we know and the faces of people we love. And for that reason, we have to get it right. And we come to a fork in the road, where we have to decide, do we use what we know or just keep bickering and selling fad diet books? So when it comes to fingers, not smoking, I think there's generally consensus. When it comes to feet and physical activity, we argue a little bit about the best ways to get there from here, but not so bad. But when it comes to what we do with our forks and dietary pattern, we're all over the map and people are hopelessly confused. And so, you know, the question then is, are we clueless about the basic care and feeding of Homo sapiens? And my answer is no. My answer is no, not just because I wish it were so, but again, based on writing 3 editions of a nutrition textbook, and then recently a paper I commend to you if you haven't seen it, Can We Say What Diet Is Best for Health? This was a commissioned review published in the Annual Review in Public Health, and all you need to do is remember that title, Google it, and the PDF is available for free. It's a featured article on their webpage, has been for months. Download the PDF, it's yours. But it's an evidence-based review, and I hope I satisfy Jim's criteria. Because, you know, I talked as much about the diets that I don't love as the diets that I do and tried to be fair. And there are studies of low-carb diets, and I don't love low-carb diets. But there are studies showing short-term weight loss benefits, and I honestly said that. And there are different ways to put together low-carb diets. But my conclusion was, what matters about diets is not what differentiates them. And I'm not the only one. There have been others looking at the same prize. Great editorial recently in The Lancet, low-carbohydrate diets going against the grain. If you guys haven't seen that, check it out. You'll love it. Tailor-made for this audience, I assure you. Frank Hugh did a great piece in The Lancet as well, looking at dietary components that defend against diabetes. But we basically all landed in the same place. So looked at evidence for and against low-fat diets, evidence for and against vegan diets, for and against low-glycemic diets, for and against the DASH diet, for and against the diabetes prevention program, for and against the paleo diet, for and against low carb, done different ways. Low carb could be meat centric, it could be the Eco-Atkins diet that David Jenkins put together, for and against the Mediterranean diet, for and against the Twinkie diet, just against the Twinkie diet. And then really what matters, you know, if you don't have a dog in the fight, if you really just care about the truth, what jumps out at you is not what differentiates these diets, but what they have in common. That olive in the middle. And nobody nailed that better, really, than Michael Pollan. Real food, not too much, mostly plants. I like to say wholesome foods and sensible combinations because it alienates our more carnivorous colleagues just a bit less. But same basic idea. Get the foods right, the nutrients take care of themselves. And there's almost no way to get the foods right and cut whole grains out entirely. You wind up with an unbalanced diet. Is that because our Stone Age ancestors ate whole grains? No. But because they ate other foods that gave them 100 grams of fiber today and all those nutrients, and we're not getting them anywhere. And there is almost inevitably a net detriment to the overall quality of diet when you exclude grains. Now, food, not too much, mostly plants, leaves quite a bit to the imagination, but I think that's fine, because frankly, I think what we want to do is love food that loves us back. And the fact that there are variations on the theme of optimal eating is only a good thing. It's your kitchen, after all. Are we eating food, not too much, mostly plants? Forget about it. The typical American diet looks like this, right? Disaster. This is from the book Hungry Planet, What the World Eats. It's a family and their food for the week. You know, maybe we need to tell them if it glows in the dark, step away from the box and nobody will get hurt. But food, not so much, mostly plants, went over like a lead balloon here, right? And this is what we need to fix. And the arguments about, you know, no, you shouldn't be eating whole grains, it does this family no good. Right? So we're debating, you know, my diet can beat your diet. Meanwhile, people are eating glow-in-the-dark junk. And again, reaping the metabolic whirlwind. I think the case is very clear that lifestyle is the best medicine, including as a centerpiece, wholesome foods and sensible combinations. What I'd like us to focus on, like us to stop the public bickering, acknowledge what we know, put it to use, and focus on how do we get this medicine to go down. Lord knows the last thing we need in modern culture is more spoons full of sugar, but I do think we need a spoon of some kind, and I would argue that the big spoon, and frankly the magnifying glass for what we know, is culture. It's not clinics. I'm a doc. The American College of Lifestyle Medicine, we talk to some extent about what we clinicians can do with our patients, but lifestyle as medicine is delivered best by a big spoon. Culture as the spoon. So my argument is lifestyle is the best medicine, inclusive of food, not too much, mostly plants. Culture is the spoon. And the best evidence we have of this is courtesy of the work of Dan Buettner in the Blue Zones. Does everybody know the Blue Zones? Everybody should know the Blue Zones in this audience. So ethnographic profile of the world's longest lived, healthiest populations. Folks, if you want to clinch the argument about the place for whole grains and a healthy diet, go to the Blue Zones. Blue Zones are all around the world. They're in Crete, they're in Okinawa, they're in Costa Rica, they're in Loma Linda, California. Dan has a new book coming out in the spring, The Blue Zone Solution. It's about the diets of the people in the Blue Zones. They're very different, right? In Loma Linda, they're vegans. In Crete, they have a Mediterranean diet. Nobody's paleo, by the way. Everybody eats whole grains. In fact, they're a centerpiece of all the Blue Zone diets. Different grains, but always prominent. And this is real world evidence of what happens to real people who live to be 100, go to sleep one night, and don't wake up. Nobody did that in the Paleolithic era, as far as we can tell. This is what works in the modern world. Unfortunately, it's not what works in our culture. For far too long, we wasted so much time bickering over what we don't know and arguing how best to sell fad diet books that we have let health lie fallow on an obstacle course. So we put health on a road that nobody can take. I think what we'd all like to do is mobilize our culture around the truth we know and put health on a path of lesser resistance. I routinely argue that we could achieve exactly that if we would see the big picture, the forest through the trees, or if you will, the elephant in the room. It was six men of Indistan, to learning much inclined, who went to see the elephant, though all of them were blind, that each by observation might satisfy his mind. The first approached the elephant and happening to fall against his broad and sturdy side at once began to bawl, God bless me, but the elephant is very like a wall. The second feeling of the tusk cried, ho, what have we here? So very round and smooth and sharp to me, 'tis mighty clear. This wonder of an elephant is very like a spear. The third approached the animal and happening to take the squirming trunk within his hands thus boldly up and spake, I see, quoth he, the elephant is very like a snake. The fourth reached out an eager hand and felt about the knee. What most this wondrous beast is like is mighty plain, quoth he. 'Tis clear enough the elephant is very like a tree. The fifth who chanced to touch the ear said, e'en the blindest man can tell what this resembles most, deny the fact who can. This marvel of an elephant is very like a fan. The sixth no sooner had begun about the beast to grope than seizing on the swinging tail that fell within his scope, I see, quoth he, the elephant is very like a rope. And so these men of Indistan disputed loud and long, each in his own opinion, exceeding stiff and strong, though each was partly in the right, and all were in the wrong. So oft in theologic wars the disputants, I ween, tread on in utter ignorance of what each other mean, and prate about the elephant not one of them has seen. Now, my friends, the problem we need to overcome is much the same in modern nutritional epidemiology. We have a vexing tendency to fail to see the elephant in the room, and in certain quarters, an equally vexing tendency to make too much noise about the mammoth that has long since exited the premises. Thank you all very much.
We have time for two or three questions. If anybody has a question, please come up to the microphone very quickly so we can keep moving.
Dr. Katz, it's very interesting to hear what you have to say, and I've been following you for a long time. In the medical medical profession, I was a cancer patient, my husband also, heart disease, everything's always a pill. Not one of my doctors could ever, ever recommend a diet. Or I would say, well, okay, what is the link of this to this, and should I be eating that? And they all would answer, I'm not a nutritionist. When are medical schools going to be offering courses on nutrition to move the doctors from reacting to a disease to preventing a disease?
There is an enormous need for there to be a greater emphasis there, and there is enormous resistance to it. And the resistance actually comes from many quarters, some of which I think everyone would anticipate, some not. First, the tradition of medicine, you know, has been a focus on certain approaches to health. It's hard to change traditions. It's like changing our own culture. When is our culture going to acknowledge that junk can't be food and food can't be junk, right? I mean, you look and see things that are just ridiculous. Food is the construction material for the growing body of a child. How we ever thought that something could both be junk and food, I don't understand that, but our culture seems to accept it. It needs to change. I would argue that medical education is a culture. The current approach to medical education goes back to the 1920s, so it's hard to change it because the people who own the turf are reluctant to surrender it and replace their courses with new ones. But it is changing. So there is a very strong emphasis in credentialing of medical schools and medical professionals that they know something about nutrition. That movement is afoot. Organizations like the American College of Lifestyle Medicine, totally devoted to this concept as well. Brilliant programs like Dean Ornish's Heart Disease Reversal Program, which after 17 years of arduous effort by Dean was finally accepted for Medicare reimbursement as an alternative to coronary bypass surgery, are showing us all the way. It can be done, but it's shockingly hard, and it's a bigger problem. Our notion, you know, we've even just talking about healthcare reform, we don't have a healthcare system by and large, right? And listen, I'm an internist, I take care of sick people. I've been there in moments of desperate need. I'm proud of that. But it's tending the sick. It's not cultivating wellness. It's what I do that's away from the bedside that's much more about cultivating wellness. It's a sick care system. It's a disease care system. And so we have this distorted perspective that healthcare is hospitals and clinics and drugs and surgery. That's not healthcare. That's disease care. We need a healthcare revolution as well. The last thing I'll say, other than acknowledging the validity of the challenge, is that this is what I want to see happen when I grow up. So as I think about my professional legacy, I want to be involved in a movement that makes lifestyle the medicine, and both clinics and cultures the spoon. Clinics the small one, cultures the big one. Let's face it, in the blue zones, you know, people don't get a lot of pills and they don't get a lot of surgery, but they're not healthy because their doctors are pointing out an alternative. Their culture is pointing out an alternative, right? So we really need those parallel tracks. I've got a project I'm working on that I hope will contribute something to that. I wouldn't hold your breath, but I wouldn't lose faith either.
I'll be waiting.
Thank you. Just as a follow-up, there's a wonderful program called Healthy Kitchens, Healthy Lives, that is teaching doctors more about the actual preparing of good food, and it's trying to spread that into hospitals. That wasn't my question.
It's a great program. And if I may, something that's easier to get your hands on, my wife recently launched a recipe website. I know some of you in the room do this as well, but these are all freely available. It's called quizinicity.com. It's all the Katz family greatest hits for all these years. So all very nutritious, but prepared by a mother of five in a busy home kitchen, so you don't need any special cooking skills. Quizinicity.com. But that's a great program.
Yeah.
Actually, one of the people who's been involved there, Julia Nordgren, who's a pediatrician trained at the Culinary Institute, we've been working with Julia to try and provide cooking classes to church congregations in the church kitchens, thinking that
that's great.
One of the things we want to do is teach the whole community how to cook.
Yeah, I mean, that's what my work is all about. That's something else.
That's right, yeah.
My question to you has to do with the studies that you cited that all come down to vegetables, fruits, and whole grains, 80% reduction in the diseases we've talked about. Were many of those studies, like the Dean Orner, I just wanted to ask you about foods excluded from those studies. For instance, with Dean Ornish, his studies, I've worked with him, exclude a lot of foods too. So how do you kind of distill studies?
Okay, so it's a very good point. So I try very hard not to reach conclusions based on any one kind of study. Mm-hmm. So, you know, if you look at the randomized controlled trials, for example, they're contrived. Mm-hmm. You know, for instance, is an optimal paleo diet or an optimal vegan diet better for health? Does anyone in the room profess to know the answer? I mean, a real paleo diet, real optimal vegan diet. I mean, consider the study you would need if you want to defend your answer robustly. A randomized trial of thousands of neonates assigned to eat paleo or eat vegan and followed for 100 years to see who lives the longest. Right? Has that been done? That has not been done. Is that going to be done? That is not going to be. What crazy person would sign their kid up, right? So, you know, what you have to do is triangulate. Say, what are the intervention trials? What do they tell us and what was contrived or left mm-hmm. out? What are the observational studies, which in some ways are much more robust about real-world conditions? So the one gives you the extreme fidelity to internal validity. Mm-hmm. The other gives you far greater fidelity to external validity. I try not to reach strong conclusions until I'm looking across that expanse. Even so, you're absolutely right. You cannot study a vegan diet that is only about what's in it and not also about what's excluded. You can't do it because, by definition, it's an all-plant diet, and therefore it is all plants, but it is also no meat. So are the benefits from what you're eating or are the benefits from what you're not eating? You then could look at something like the studies of the Mediterranean diet. And by the way, you know, Dean's an interesting character because while a lot of the guys in that space, you know, who have lifelong reputations working with a plant-based diet, become pretty zealous about that. You know, Colin Campbell is pretty zealous. John McDougall's pretty zealous. Cal Esselstyn's pretty zealous. Dean is a pragmatist and, you know, sort of looks around and says, you know, how are people really eating? And, you know, he reads the same literature about the Mediterranean diet as the rest of us. The Lyon diet heart study. Mediterranean diet intervention, in people who'd had an MI, 70% reduction in the rate of recurrent MI, Mediterranean diet as compared to a conventional Western European diet. That's every bit as good as anything Dean's been able to show, right? And that's a diet that includes meat. Now, not a lot. It's not a carnivorous diet, but there's definitely fish and seafood, and there is lean meat as a relatively modest component of that diet. Other than that, it's rich in vegetables, fruits, grains, beans, legumes, nuts, seeds, the usual suspects, olives, olive oil. So if you look across the full expanse, you say, okay, well, this is really good and excludes meat completely. This is just as good as best we can tell and doesn't exclude meat. Mm-hmm. What do they have in common? Yeah. And I think you settle on the core fundamental truths, which are about what's included. But the last component to the answer is you're onto something really important. I've actually written about this quite a bit. The notion that we have a blind spot in nutritional epidemiology. We think about here's what you should eat, and fail to consider what will you stop eating as a result? Or here's what you shouldn't eat, what will you start eating as a result? I mean, for example, we warn people at risk for heart disease to stop eating eggs. Did it ever dawn on us that the result would be America runs on Dunkin', right? And tell them what they've won, Johnny. They stopped eating eggs, they started eating more donuts. So I think that's an important notion, that what we eat is good for what it puts into our diet, it may be good for what it displaces, or vice versa. What we eat may be bad, both because we're eating more of it and less of something that's better for us. So it's an important principle.
Thank you very much.
Thank you all.